First of all, let me thank the organizers for giving me an opportunity to talk about my research work on temple architecture. Temple and its concepts and its manifestation in the physical form. Any structure constructed in India in the past followed the tenets of Vastushastra. Vastushastra can be viewed as an encompassing science of built spaces and its environs. The term Vastu is interpreted in many ways. As given in Rig Veda, Vastu means a place where all living organisms reside. Vasanti Pranina Yatra. In harmony with each other. Science or Shastra dealing with Vastu is Vastushastra. Number of scriptures with the interpretations of the authors written at various periods are available. Texts incorporating the regional variations are followed in most regions. In Kerala, a regional text, Tantra Samuchaya, written by Sri Chenasa Narayanan Nambudripada in the 15th century is being followed in temple construction. Temple, the abode of God, is a physical structure. The construction follows the philosophy, concepts, and principles laid down in Vastushastra. There may be some relaxation in planning and construction of other buildings, but this is strictly followed in the design of inner space of a temple consisting of sanctum sanctorum and its immediate space around it. Temple complex consists of three spaces: Antarhara, inner space; Madhyahara, middle space; and Bahirhara, outer space. Though based on a universal theme, regional variations of climate, material, social, and political influences are apparent in planning as well as in the visual and architectural characteristics of temples. Design especially observed in Madhyahara and Bahirhara. Temples in Kerala are a class by itself. In contrast to the temples in other parts of India, the temples in Kerala are smaller in size and scale, and no part of the temple is visible from the distance as they are camouflaged by the vegetation. This is the normal temple constructed in Kerala. And this is a temple in Thrissur, which has been distorted. The vegetation has been cut off in many places, but still it conveys the idea of a temple camouflaged by vegetation. The development of structural temple in Kerala from the traditional Nadikatta and its similarity with the residential complex is striking, both in the planning of spaces and the scale of the structure. The present talk focuses on the temples in Kerala, discusses how concepts translate into physical manifestation. Positioning of the temple with respect to town. The temple occupy the central portion of any town planning scheme. In the schematic diagram, as given in the text Samarangana Sutradhara, as shown here, the town is divided into nine squares in the Paramasayaga Padavinyasa, consisting of the Brahma Vidhi, is set apart for the temple complex. Central portion set apart for the temple complex. This can be there can be regional variations in the plan. The fort in Tripunitra is a good example of a temple town in Kerala. The original plan of Tripunitra is in Asanapadam, 10 into 10 squares, with the temple of Sri Purnatraisha occupying in the central four padams. Normal cases, there will be four entry to the temple, but in this case, there are only three gobirams. The fourth one in the north opens to the temple dining hall. Concept of the temple. the ancient Indians struck a note of spirituality that permeates the rhythmical order of creation. According to Indian philosophy, the universe Brahmandam, or the sphere of Brahma, is an all-encompassing system of immeasurable attributes whose minutest element Pindandam also exhibits all its characteristics and manifests itself in as the representative of the whole. This basic philosophy is transferred to the field of architecture, wherein the space is considered as the universe and the built space is considered as its manifestation at the micro level. Each space, small or large, thus becomes self-contained with all attributes of the larger space. The built form is related to the space, and the elements of the built form are related to one another and to the whole. It's also believed that there is a force that moves mysteriously in the universe. In Vastushastra, this spirit is known as Vastu Purusha. It is revealed in an ascending degree in forms that are perfect. Of all the forms in nature, the human form is the most perfect, for it is the most organic in nature. The system of relationship is evident there, and all parts are harmonized in one living unity. Every member of the body bears responsibility to its unity, which rules the entire universe. In architectural term, this corresponds to the individual elements, which acts independently and is in harmony with each other and to the whole. This is further established by the concepts and principles followed in real construction. Concept of the universe. Universe is conceived as a spherical form with 10 gods protecting its boundary. The 8 gods Ashtadikpalakas occupy the horizontal central space, while Brahma occupies the top, Zenith, and Ananda at the bottom, Nadir. It has only one axis and is very unstable. For construction purpose, you require a stable form. The form has to be close to a sphere with all its manifestations. Accordingly, the central horizontal circular space of the sphere has been changed to a square, as the square is the closest form of a circle. And the sphere thus becomes a tetrahedron by joining the zenith and nadir with the corners of the temple. Now the form has been stable with all the three axes. For all construction purposes, this form is adapted. So the universe in the architectural term is the tetrahedral form with the central space as a square. Concept of Vastu Purusha. As mentioned earlier, it is believed that there is a force that moves mysteriously in the universe. As per Vastushastra, this force is termed as Vastu Purusha. Vastu Purusha is encompassing the universal space as well as the designed space. Like Akasha or Ether, taking the shape of the container and at the same time remaining at large, Vastu Purusha spreads itself into the plots, small or large. He is graphically portrayed in a square with his head in the northeast Ishana corner and his feet in the southwest with his face down. It is portrayed as a human form, as the human form is the perfect form in most organic in nature. It is clearly visible here that is a square space, and you can see the form of the Vastu Purusha with his head on the northeast corner and his feet at the southwest corner. Concept of the mandala. Mandala is a defined space of any form or scale. Mandala is a two-dimensional representation of a three-dimensional space. Classic texts specify the Vastu Purusha mandala as a square. However, circular, triangular, hexagonal, octagonal mandalas are referred in the text. Two or more mandalas can be combined together to form a larger mandala or a Rajal mandala can be subdivided into smaller one. Each may thus be analyzed independently. This aspect is identical to the modern system approach. Now the concept of the pada, a unit, sector, and padavinyasam, sectorization. Division of a larger unit to the smaller unit is known as padavinyasam. Accordingly, Vastupurusha mandala is divided into smaller squares from 1 into 1 to 32 into 32 or larger. 8 into 8, 9 into 9, and 10 into 10 are used for secular buildings. In case of temples, the smallest temple is in 9 into 9 padavinyasam and the large temple is in 15 into 15 padavinyasam. Instances of very large temple with the padavinyasam can also is also available. It can go up to 43 into 43 padams. In case of temple, one padam is equal to the width of the garbhagriha. In case of a square one, or the diameter in case of a circular one. It is also termed as a danda in planning. Now coming to the principles. The Ayadi Shadvarga. Six parameters of design starting with ayam. In Vastushastra, the design of any space is based on the perimeter of the space. The measurement of the perimeter is decided based on six parameters known as IRD Shadvargam. Ayam, Vyayam, Age, Nakshatram, Tithi and Yoni. In temples, these are strictly followed in arriving at the perimeter of the Garbhagriha. Of the six parameters, the most important aspect is the Yoni, which denotes the positioning of the structure with respect to its facing. For practical purposes, odd numbers denoting the cardinal points only are relevant as the structures face cardinal directions only. Yoni 1, Dhvaja Yoni, denotes the east. Yoni 3, Simha Yoni, denotes south. Yoni 5, Vrishabha Yoni, denotes west. And Yoni 7, Gaja Yoni, denotes north. The perimeter of the temple Trigovil facing east will be in the Vrishabha Yoni or Yoni 5, and the temple facing west will be in Dhvaja Yoni. The Yoni of the various other structures inside will also follow this Yoni concept. Namaskara Mandalam will have the opposite Yoni of the Trigovil as it faces the Trigovil. 2. Sutra Vedam, another principles which is strictly followed in the construction. Non-coinciding of the central lines. The arrangements of the various parts of the temple are in an axial form, starting from the gopuram entry point, then gopuram, then Nadapura, Dhvajastambam, Balikkalpura, Edanadi, flanked by Valiyambalam, Namaskara Mandapam, Sobanam, Srigovil and Gopuram on the exist side. You can clearly see the various points in this here. The legends show the details. Though axial in planning, the central line or the sutram of each structure is shifted to avoid sutra vedam, where no two central lines coincide. An important aspect of temple planning. The shift known as gamanam is physically visible when you look at the temple from outside. The shift is always towards the right in a clockwise direction. All elements, including the structural, non-structural, come under this. The deity is visible from the point beyond the stambam or even from the gopuram because of this principle. V of the Purnatraisha temple from the western side. This is a Purnatraisha temple, view of the temple from the western side. You can clearly see the shifting of the central line of each element inside the photo. And the view of the Ullur temple from the western gopuram. One is in Ernakulam, the other one is in Trivandrum. You can see the shift of the central points. Scale and proportions used in the temple. The standard measurement used in the Vastushastra is known as an angulam. it's approximately equal to 25 centimeters. And multiples of it. Angulam, which is the basic dimension, decided on the following scale, starting from Paramanu. Paramanu is described as the size of a minute aerosol particles seen in a dark chamber when the sun's rays creep into it. One angulum is equal to 262,144 times the Paramanu. Eight angulum makes one padam and three padam makes one kola, measuring 72 to 75 centimeters, which is the standard scale used in Vastushastra. Danda, measuring four poles, is also used as a scale in the construction of larger buildings and planning of large complexes. Smaller units are also used in detailing parts of the structure. In residential buildings, an angulum is the measurement of the middle portion of the middle finger of the master. This is known as matrangulam, which is shown in the drawing. Proportionate angulum. As the term denotes, the actual measurement of the angulum is flexible. As it is cumbersome to use matrangulam, the scale is standardized at regional levels. Measurement of one pole in South Kerala is approximately 75 cm, while that of the North Kerala is approximately 72 cm. Measurement of scale in the other parts of India are different. But the scale used in the construction of the temple is related to the size of the idol, which in terms decide the size of the Garbhagriha. For planning purposes, the unit measurement used is known as danda, which is equal to the width of the diameter of the Garbhagriha, if it is a circular one, or the length of the Garbhagriha, if it is square, and is related to the standard measurement of the angulam and kol. Scale used in the temple is usually inscribed on the basement of the gobiram and used for the construction of buildings in the vicinity. Proportions of the temple. In temples, the proportionate system is used. All measurements of the temple plan is based on the standard unit of danda. The basic unit considered for the planning of the temple is equal to the external width or diameter of the Garbhagriha, where the idol of deity is placed. As explained earlier, measurement of the danda is proportionate to the measurement of the idol. Danda is used as a unit or module for the planning and construction of the temples as per the Sandra Samuchaya. This book is written by Chennasa Narayana Nambudiripada in the 15th century. All important elements like height and foundation of the structure, roof, doors, windows, etc. are proportionate to the idol. This proportionate system is visible to the common man when he compares the size of the temple of Sri Krishna in Guruvayur or the temple of Shasta at Shabarimala to that of Padmanabhaswamy temple, Thiruvananthapuram, or Purnatraisha temple at Punitra, or Shiva temples at Ettimanur, Vaikyam, or Thrissur. As per the scripture, Tantra Samuchaya, temple is divided into five enclosures, pragarams. They are Andar Mandala, Nalambalam, Velakkum Madam, Pradakshinavali, and Maryada. A fully developed temple complex consists of 15 into 15 units. The Garbhagriha consists of one unit. It's clearly visible from the drawing. The second pragaram, Nalambalam, is one unit away from the sanctum, consists of nine units. The third pragaram, Velakkumadam, is two units away from the sanctum, consisting of 25 units. Fourth pragaram, Pradakshinavali, is four units away from the sanctum, consists of 81 units. And the last pragaram, Maryada, is seven units away from the sanctum, consisting of 225 units. Tantra Samuchayam also says that Maryada can be 21 units away from the sanctum, consisting of 1419 units. Planning of space in the temple complex. The temple is again divided into three spaces. Inner space, Andarhara, consisting of space confined within the second pragaram or the Nalambalam. This also can be designated as a private space. Entry to the Garbhagriha is restricted to the temple priests. In the remaining area of the inner space, entry is allowed at specific time and with restrictions. The Madhyahara consists of space confined within the third pragaram. This is a semi-public place where more leniency in the usage can be seen. The third space or bahirhara is the outer space within the madhyada. No restrictions are enforced, especially during festivals. Garbhagriha, sanctum sanctorum. Garbhagriha is the house of God as well as its representation. According to Shilparatna, prasada, temple structure, is to be worshipped as Purusha. The several parts of the temple communicate this living presence and are likened to the body of the man, in the same way as Vastu Mandala is related to Vastu. The names of the limbs of the body are hence applied to denote the different parts of the temple structure, especially the Sri Govi, such as Upapita, feet, Adhisthana, knee, Pada, limbs, Prasthara, shoulder, Khanda, neck, Shikhara, face, Thubi, tuft. The Garbhagriha contains the life of the temple. It is conceived from inside and visualized from outside. The ruling idea of the unity is expressed in the harmonious relationship of the spirit and the body. Now, planning of the Garbhagriha. In any temple, Garbhagriham or Sanctum Sanctorum is the most important part of the temple. It occupies the central padam of a temple complex. And the measurement of the temple complex is based on the measurement of the Garbhagriham. The Garbhagriham is planned in 5 into 5 padams. It is shown here. 5 into 5 padams. Here, one padam is equal to the width of the pidam. Here, one padam is equal to the pidam. The entire area is one danda as per the temple construction. And this Garbhagriham, again, it is divided into 5 into 5 padavinyasam. And one padam of that is the size of the pidam. Surrounding space of one pidam is used as an ambulatory space inside. And the wall occupies the next padam. The width of the Garbhagriham, the unit measurement used for the designation of additional spaces. Smallest temple seen in Kerala consists of 3 pragarams and confined within 3 into 3 padavinyasams. The basic philosophy universal space incorporated in the planning of the temple is explained here. As described earlier, this is a plan of a temple. As described earlier, the plan of a fully developed temple consists of 5 boundaries. And the innermost pragaram is Sandar Mandalam, which consists of the sanctorum and the belivattam, space confined with the 10 bellicles representing the Ashtadikpalakas and Brahma and Ananda. The Ashtadikpalakas occupy the respective places. These are the Ashtadikpalakas and Brahma. This is Brahma and this is Ananda. The Ashtadikpalakas occupy the respective places in the cardinal points. Of the additional 2 bellicles, one representing Brahma is provided on the eastern periphery away from the Ishana towards east, and the second one representing the Ananda is provided on the western periphery away from the Nirudhi towards Varuna west. The 10 bellicles occupying the periphery of the Andar Mandala confirms the concept of the universe and its physical manifestation in the temple design. The second pragaram is defined by the chuttambalam or the nalambalam. This chuttambalam or nalambalam. The space within the first and second pragaram is sandhara. Third pragaram defined by valakumadam. In the periphery of the third pragaram is also provided with 10 bellicles. Again, reasserts the concept of the universe. Every temple, including the smallest one, will have all these 3 pragarams. Main entry with the Govaram is placed at a strategic point with respect to the existing road. When you stand at the center of the Govaram, entrance of the Govaram, you will get a view of the various parts of the temple. Entrance, Govaram entrance, and you will get the entire part of the temple. The temples normally face east or west. There are some exceptions to this rule, especially when the temples are dedicated to Durga in the Raudra Bhava. Here the temple faces the north direction. Example, good example of that is Atukal Devi Temple in Trivandrum and Kadungalur Devi Temple, Kodungalur, and Mukkoti Temple in Tripunitra. Development of, now we are coming, but the, this is a general concept of the temple design. Now we are coming directly to the development of temple in Kerala. Kerala always had an independent existence. Very few movements, social, political, or religious, have influenced the socio-cultural position of this narrow strip, protected on the eastern side by the high mountain range and on the western side by the sea. This is visible when we study the development of the temples here. The temple, as we see today, have come to existence during the Bhakti movement in the 8th century AD. Kerala was famous for its nature worship and ancestral worship from time immemorial. Existence of small structures known as Thekkada, where ancestors are worshipped, is part of the residential complex in ancient time. Nature worship also was part of the residential planning, especially the planning of a large house complexes of Tharavada. The Kshetragandam, the residential complex is divided into four portions: Devakhandam, southwest sector; Vayukhandam, northwest sector; Manushakhandam, northeast sector; and Yamakhandam, southeast sector. The main structure of the Naluvetta and its ancillary units occupy the Manushakhandam, and the Devakhandam, southwest sector, is always left as an undisturbed area for natural vegetation. This space is usually referred to as a kavar, meaning a small forest. This area is normally undisturbed with the provision of a Nagatara, abode for the snakes, and the abode of celestial creatures like Yakshis and Gandharvas. The strategic position of the kavar protects the habitable area from the ravages of southwest monsoon. Also provides undisturbed green space covering 25% of the Kshetragandam, which is essential for achieving environmental balance with nature. The term kavar is referred to the later temples. Almost all of them are dedicated to goddess Durga in many forms. The legends associated with almost all the Tharavads of feudal lords also talk about a benevolent goddess bringing food to the members of the family during adverse times and disappearing to the ara, or the granary of the Tharavada, situated inside the Nadugat. Lighting the lamp in front of the ara, even today, signifies this. A small temple dedicated to the goddess, known as the Paradevada, later becoming the presiding goddess of the entire village, also is seen in many villages. Existence of a similar concept is also seen in the provision of a mullatara. This is the mullatara, where the goddess of mullatara is worshipped by the women of the household. This strong association of the residences and the temples is a unique feature of ancient worship in Kerala. Later, for various reasons, the temples have been removed from the residential complexes and were constructed independently. But the basic planning principles remain the same. Similarities of the planning of the Naligatta with that of an independent structural temple are striking. Both has three spaces: inner space, middle space, and outer space. The inner space of the Naligatta consists of the courtyard and the surrounding veranda. The middle space consists of built space of Kerakini, Tekkini, Padinyatini, and Vadakini. The buildings constructed at the cardinal points and is confined within a padavinyasam of 5x5, 25 padams. Outer space consisting of the open veranda and surrounding open space is confined to 9x9 padavinyasam, 81 padams. The transition stage in the development of temple in Kerala is seen in the temple of the Paradevada, family deity of the Cochin royal family. Here the Naligatta constructed close to the Maharaja's residence has been converted into a structural temple is given in figure. All details given in the Tantra Samuchaya is followed in the planning. Though it is in the form of a Naligatta, this is the temple, this is the surrounding space, Nalambalam, which is similar to Nalambalam, which is confined into 3x3 square, and then it comes 5x5 and It's 9 into 9. 81 padams. The Sri Kovil of the Paradevda Kochi royal family is constructed in the courtyard of Naligatta. The Nadumittam and the Veranda of the Naligatta consists of the Sri Kovil and the Balivattam. Is in 3 into 3 Padavinyasam. The external veranda with the columns is in 9 into 9 Padavinyasam. The Kirakini is provided for the temples of the Upadevadas and the Padinyatini acts as the Edanari and Valiambalam. Vadakini, that is the northern space, accommodates the temple kitchen and the space for conducting rituals. And the southern space, Tekini, is left open. As this is a temple in a private property and is used exclusively by the royal family spaces, like the Madhyahara and Bahihara are not identified. When temples have been shifted from the residential enclosure to public use, the three distinct spaces can be seen. General in planning of the temple in the Paramasayika Padam, the Panja Pragarams given in the Santasamsha is clearly visible inside the planning. This is the plan of a typical temple in 9 into 9 Padavinyasam. General plan of the temple in Kerala comes Padavinyasam 9 into 9, identical to that of the planning of the Naligatta. This is the uniqueness of the Kerala temple. Andhahara with the first two pragarams is 3 into 3 Padavinyasam. Third and fourth pragaram consisting of Adakamadam Pradashnaviri is confined within 5 into 5 Padavinyasam. And the fifth pragaram outer vault is confined in 9 into 9 Padavinyasam, similar to Naligatta in plan. There are temples in Kerala where the outer wall is not confined within the 9 into 9 Padavinyasam, but extended to larger Padavinyasam as given in Tantra Samuchaya. Poonatraisha temple is one such temple where the Bahihara is extended so that to accommodate 15 elephants during the festivals. Now, architectural character. The important architectural feature of any temple complex are the Vimanam of the Sri Kovil and the Gopuram. In Dravidian temples, the Vimana as well as the Gopuram are important structures. The Vimanam of the Brihadeshwara temple Tanjavur and the Gopurams of Madhura Meenakshi, Brihadeshwara temple, Madhura Meenakshi temple, this is Somanatha temple, this is Puri Jagannatha temple, and this is the Gopuram of Madhura Meenakshi, are imposing structures. Other structures in the temple complex like 100-pillared hall of Meenakshi temple and the long corridor of Sri Rameshwaram temple constructed in granite are also examples of the grandeur of the temple architecture. In other part of India also, Vimanam of the temple is most striking structure. Puri Jagannatha temple in Orissa, Somanatha temple in Gujarat are some other examples. Comparing to these imposing temple structures, the temples of Kerala are smaller in size and relate themselves to the human scale. Now you relate, this is the temple, Poonatraisha temple in full view. And you can relate the size and scale of the temple to that of a human scale. In Kerala, the Vimana of the sanctum is very simple with steep sloping roof and very wide projection of eave. The general architectural character of Kerala temple having low profile for all the structures including the Vimanam of the structure, Gopuram, etc. is seen in the photo 10. You can even see that this is the Gopuram and this is the flag mast, this is the Sri Kovil, Mandapam, etc. In case of Didala temples, where the Sri Kovil has higher Vimana, again, it is in a very small scale. This is Peruvanam temple, where the Vimana of the temple is in 2 stories. The most important architectural element, though smaller in size in a Kerala temple, is the Gopuram. The temple Gopuram is also similar to the Padipira Vadil of any large Tharavad, emphasizing the similarity of the residential complex and the relation to the human scale. The smaller temples, the Gopuram is single story. In larger temples, they are 2 or more stories. All the Gobra has the lower story with added height for providing tall opening for the elephants to pass. This is known as Anavadil. This wall with the tall openings defines the Madhyada. The exterior space of the Gobram is always outside the Madhyada. The entry to the higher floor is provided from the inside. The Gobram acts as a sentry point and protects the temple interiors. The Gobrams normally seen can be divided into two types. One is framed and the other load-bearing. Frame structure in South Kerala, as you see now, this is a frame structure. The central portion of the ground floor, which forms part of the Madhyada, is done in brick or laterite, and the entry with the Anavadil is provided at the center. The first floor is the frame structure done in wood with windows openings on all the four sides. Gables with intricate details are also provided on both ends. Ullur Temple Gobram is a good example of that. That is from outside and that's from inside. In North Kerala, the Gobrams are in the load-bearing type and larger in size. The Gobram floor is provided with rooms on either side, with the entry and the Anavadil at the center forms part of the Madhyada. One of the two stories are added with the same style with windows openings in the four directions. The roof is provided with gables at the top. Interim sloping sunshades are also provided at every floor. The Western Gobram of Purnatraisha Temple is a good example of that. And this is the Eastern Gobram, which has been constructed at a later period, also have a load-bearing structure. And this is a larger Gobram of Vadakkunnatha Temple in Thrissur. With this, I think I have conveyed how the concept, philosophy and principles laid down in the Vastushastra, how it has already been done in the physical format, and the uniqueness of Kerala temples relating to the temples in other part of India. Thank you for your listening.
So our Karni asks, I noticed one legend, Palyad Kal. He says, I may have made some mistakes in noting it. It means sacrificial stone. Does it mean animal sacrifice was or is practiced in temples?
Abelical. That is the sacrificial stone that is that denotes the Ashtadikpalakas and Brahma and Ananda. And during every puja, sacrifices in the form of rice and water and flour will be offered to all these places. This is giving food to all the creatures in the universe.
Okay, so it may not necessarily mean animal sacrifice.
It's not, no. It is giving food to all the elements, all the living elements around the universe, inside the universe. That is being done 3 times a day. In almost all the temples, it is done 3 times.
Temples of North India are completely different from temples of South India, especially and when it comes to South India temples. What do you mean by Vimana?
Vimana is the structure constructed over the Sanctum Sanctorum. Srikovil, Sanctum Sanctorum. The roof of the Sanctum Sanctorum is known as Vimana. This is a Gobram and this is the Vimana. The tallest structure is Vimana, which comes over the Srikovil, Garbhagriha. Here again, it is like that, Brihadeshwara Temple. It's the Vimana that is above the Garbhagriha. Whereas in Madhura, this is a Gobram. That is the entry point. This is the picture showing the scale of a temple. It's one of the biggest temples or the largest temples in Kerala, Purnatraisha Temple. And now you see, this is the Vimana, the size, the scale of the Vimana and the surrounding structures, etc. of a Kerala temple. The Gobram, this is the smallest one, which is highly invisible here. That just shows the uniqueness of the Kerala temple and its similarity to a residential complex. And this is a place where the residential members of the royal family watches the festivals of the temple. It's part of the residential complex. And the scale of this and the scale of the temple is almost identical. And it confirms the human scale. So when you see the temple in Kerala, you are never in awe. Like when you see the Gobiram of Madura Meenakshi temple or the Vimanam of the Brihadeshwara temple. Kerala always had an independent existence. It was not influenced by any movements that has happened outside Kerala. And that is why the development of the Kerala temples are unique. Only exception is that the inner space of Kerala temple, the size, the proportions of the inner space of the temple, the planning of the space is identical to the planning of any Andhrahara of any temple anywhere in India. Because the inner space is always confirmed to what have been given in the Vastushastra. It's followed very strictly. And that's the case everywhere in India. The inner space, the planning, not the architectural or the third dimension. But the planning of the inner space of the temple is identical all over India. This is one picture which shows one of the important aspects of construction. That is, I told you that the building is in a linear format on an axial basis. But when you look at the individual structures, you will see that the central line of each one is shifted towards the right. Here, this is shifted towards right from this point. This point is shifted from this point. This is the temple lamp. It is shifted. This is shifted. And you can see that very clearly when you look at the building from a distance. That is, one person can have only one central point. You cannot, two persons cannot occupy the same place. And the same place means the center. Now, if you put a window and if you put a column and if you have a window and a column, the center line of the window and the center line of the column cannot be the same. Or the center line of the window and the center line of the jamb, the vertical jamb, it cannot be in the same line. It's applicable in all the constructions. Whatever that you construct, there should not be anything which occupies the same central line. That should be shifted. It's true in the residential buildings also. But it's very visible because residential buildings, it is not visible. But from the temples, it is very clearly visible. And that is one reason why we can see the idol of the god from the Gobiram because of the shift.
I have a question. So that means that the modern buildings that we are constructing are completely haywire because in Vastu they lay a lot of importance to the central point of the house,
yes,
or of the plot.
Yes.
But here our central point may fall in the kitchen or in the back room or in the middle of a bedroom. It's not always in the modern apartment buildings. And number two, all the apartments, whatever is the center point of an apartment, like see in my house, there is a lawn in front and a lawn at the back. So we don't really know which is the central point of the plot itself. And if it is an apartment, then the central point falls the same for all the flats in the building. Would you like to say something about that?
Yes. The first thing is that they are not aware of the Vastushastra, the principles of Vastushastra. But when you take the building independently and then you can take the complex as a whole, each will have a central point, independent central point. Your house will have a central point and if your room will have a central point, and there should not be anything at the central point in any place, any space. Maybe that may be correct knowingly or unknowingly, but I don't think it is knowingly because people are not aware of the intricacies that is being said in the Vastushastra. So normal concept is that there is nothing serious about Vastushastras, what has been given in the Vastushastra. But then only when you go through that, then only you will realize how seriously they have taken into consideration of each and every point in design. For example, the scale of a building. For example, we take the temple. The scale of the temple, maybe it is 75 centimeter taller. But when it comes to the measurement of the plot, the measurement of scale is different. It may not be 75 centimeters, it is slightly higher. We call it as a scale. We call it as three-chord scale. We call it as a kishku, 24 angulam scale. But the actual measurement for each scale is different, which is used for the temple, which is used for the elements of the temple, which is used for the measurement of the land. It is different.
Yeah. So if we consider one flat and we consider that the center point, there is no wall or a door that falls in the center point, considering maybe it falls in the living room.
Yes.
Then all the flats above it and all the flats below it will also have that same central, you know, axis.
It as for the Vastushastra, it is not correct. There should be a slight shift. It need not be even a visible shift. They say that the shift of the width of one thread, how much will be that? A shift of that, because it is known as sutram. Sutram is thread. So the shift can be even one thread shift is that is enough. So when you actually measure it, there will be a shift like that. Most probably there will be a shift.
Probably that is why that in the traditional buildings and temples, you never have these multi-storied complex. They're always like single-storied.
But the gobrams of many temples have multi-buildings. But you see that there will be a shift. Central line of that will be shifted. So here, you will see the intricate detailing of on the temple, on the surface of the temple. When you go into the detail, each panel will have its own scale and proportions. In actual measurement, it will be, it need not be in the angulum measurement, it can be lower measurement, but that will be the. And that scale used for this will not be the same as that will be used for the inner detailing. The scale will be different. Actual measurement of the scale will be different. We say that it is a scale, it is a collar, but the actual measurement will be different. For normal structures, we take angulum as the basic measurement. But if it is a smaller elements, it will be the smaller things will be taken. Now this is now you can see the difference between these. This is a Dravidian type of vimanam, and this is the northern type of vimanam. You will see the detailing different, and this is also in the axial measurement. And normally, if you look from you sit at this point at the entry point. I think that there will be a shift. You will perceive the shift. If it is done as per the Vastushastra, there will be a shift. I have not gone into the detail of the planning, but normally there will be a shift. That is the basic principle of design as per Vastushastra.
And one more question. That in North India, since because of the wars and whatever reasons, the traditional architecture has not got time to develop or to be retained as such in temples. So our temples may be constructed in the middle of an apartment building, and they're more like a department store where all the gods are lined up from, you know, top to bottom. There's no one Garbhagriha, or even if there is, they may be like, say, Radha Krishna in there and surrounded by Hanuman and multiple other deities. In this case, does it make a difference to the energy of the temple, to the energy of the land?
Definitely. Each temple, each sanctorum had a space around it which has the energy from that sanctum sanctorum. And there is a confined space, because when it is moves away from the sanctum sanctorum, the energy will fade. And if you have another temple nearby, it will have another energy field. And that also recedes from when it goes moves away from the sanctum sanctorum. In small temples and the small the structures, the energy that flows out of the temple is smaller comparing to the larger temples.
And there is a question, what are your recommendations for the idols or the small temple, for the shrines and idols and small temples that we have at home?
You should never have a temple inside your home. Because in Kerala, we have already taken all the temples away from the homes and started constructing outside. Now, bringing back the temples inside, I think that it is not a correct way of doing, because it will affect the energy fields inside the inside the house. You can have some space where you can do some worship, you can light a lamp and things like that, but not a temple inside any home. That is my personal.
I think the person means this only. He says small shrines, which may be in a shelf or a cupboard also.
No, that cannot be considered as a temple. It's only a place of worship, that's all. It's not a temple. It cannot be considered as a temple as such. It's a place where you can light a lamp. But still, I feel that there will be some energy coming out of that small place. And we keep that temple, that place where you keep the idols and the light in a strategic cardinal point, whether on the eastern side or the western side. Not on the northern side or the southern side, or on the corners. It always faces either east or west. That is important.
This is very interesting. If you could expand more on this, on home shrines inside the home. One is about the direction, you said. Two, you said it should not be in a corner. Any more recommendations?
It should be at a strategic point. In residential buildings, in normal in Kerala houses, when you enter the house, the first thing that you will be seeing will be the entry to your place of worship. It should not be in an obscure corner. It should not be in a faraway place. When you enter the house, the first thing that you should see should be the light that you are lighting in front of the God. So that should be the strategy point. So that is why we say that all the buildings should face the cardinal points. You should not face, you cannot face the corners and things like that as we do now. I think that it is still possible, because even if you have a very disturbed land and things like that, not a square land and things like that, but when you plan independent houses or independent flats, I think it is still possible to put all these things in proper places. This is the temple, Puri temple in Orissa. Puri Jagannatha temple. You see the detailing is totally different. When you look at this temple, the detailing is totally different. But when you look at the plan, then you will see that axial positioning of the Sri Govil or the Garbhagriha and the exit point. It will be in the same line, axial line. Of course, there will be a shift in the central line of each building. This, the central line of this will be different from central line of this, will be different from central line of this, different from central line of this. A slight shift. If you go and observe, normally nobody would have observed that. But if you observe it, I am 100% sure that there will be a shift at the central line of each structure. Central line of this building, central line of this building, all the buildings will be shifted on a clockwise pattern.
The first question is, are family temples of Paradevatas subject to the same considerations that she talks of as regards concept, philosophy and principles and design? Number one question. Number two question, are Nagar Kavus subject to the same considerations of the temples that she talks about? And number three,
are temples with Shaligramam and Haigriva Murti subject to the same considerations or different considerations?
The first is the temple of Paradevata. Now, if it is inside, there can be two ways of doing the Paradevata worship. It can be either as a part of the temple structure, as in the Brahmin's Naligatta, Nambudri's Naligatta, you will have a puja muri. And inside the puja muri, the measurement of the puja muri will be a square. And the center of the puja muri will be the place where you keep your idols and you do the pujas. So in planning, the principle of temple design is being followed there also. And the number two question, what's the number two question? A Nagarkava. The Nagarkava, the position of the Nagarkava is always on the normally on the northwest side of the temples, or as in the residential building. But the planning of the place of worship, that follows the planning principles laid down in the Vastushastra. Because the size of the idol, the size of the pedam, and the size of the surrounding space all follow the principles laid down in the Vastushastra.
I'm talking of a Paradevata temple in the compound, not in the house.
Yes, you have to definitely, you have to follow, and you have to follow all the principles laid down in Tantra Samuchaya. If it is in Kerala, it follows all the principles laid down in Tantra Samuchaya. Only thing is that it comes under the category of Alpakshetra, small temple. So we'll not be having all the spaces. Mostly it will have only the Andhahara with the Velakumada. It will maximum it will have the Velakumadam up to that point. There will be no Madhahara or the Bahirhara.
Are there any special considerations for a Paradevata family temple which has houses, Shaligramam and a Haigriva Murti?
No, the same principle will be followed. The Shaligramam will, for example, you will keep the Shaligramam as part of in the pedam, and the pedam will be having the proportions and things like that. You can have any number of, because it is a movable thing. The Shaligramam is a movable thing. So you will be having a number of Shaligrams which we put in a place, pedam, and the pedam will be acting as the temple.
My question was, would you have come across, or are there any examples of Dravidian temples that might be in India but may have been destroyed due to invasion, etc.?
I have not come across that. The term Dravidian and Indo-Saracenic, this all depends on the architectural style. Basically, the plan of the temple, whether it is all over India, which follows the Vastushastra, have the same principles in planning.
Is there any difference in architecture between the Shaivite and Vaishnavite temples?
Detailing, there will be some temples, but in planning, there is no change. Detailing, when the detailing of a Shaiva temple and the detailing of the exterior of a Vaishnava temple may be different. Detailing. But when it comes to the planning, actually the Vastushastra talks about the planning, basically the planning. And the third dimension is depends, as I told you earlier also. It's the Andhahara is the most important place of the temple, and that follows strictly the tenets laid down in the Vastushastra. The second and third, it's all depends on the socio-cultural, economic, political influences of that place. For example, in Kerala, we never see larger buildings because stone is not available, because it's a coastal area. When the stone is available, you make from the stone. If it is a red stone, you make it in the red stone. If it is the soapstone, you make the construction in soapstone, like that. And with the material, there will be a change in the architectural style. But architectural style, the changes in the architectural style does not mean that there is a change in the basic planning principles of the temple. all over India, it's the same. The planning principles are the same.
What do you have to say that about temple reconstruction, which in which they are painting the temple, the stone columns with acrylic paints now?
I'm totally against that. The temple is not for the exterior presentation. It's for the interior space that sanctum sanctorum that matters. I think that nothing will be given even in the modern temples. The sanctum sanctorum and the immediate surroundings are left free. Only the third, the second, Madhyahara and Andhahara, that is being given all this painting and things like that, acrylic painting and things like that. Not in the inner portion of the temple. Even now, I think that I have not seen any place where these things have been added to the inner space of the temple. And now this is where the temple will be placed. In place, in a town, the temple always occupies the central portion. And then it is divided into eight sectors. Each town is divided into each sectors, and each sector can have a temple, the sector temple. Each sector can have a temple. And then again, it is divided into smaller places, and each central portion will have a temple. So, in a town, there will be hierarchical temples. The largest one will be occupying the center of the town, and there will be in each sector, there will be as well, if it, in a residential complex also, you can have a small temple with respect to that portion.
Oh, so that explains Pushkar. I have been to this place, Pushkar, where the lake is entirely surrounded by small temples.
And this is one of the oldest gobirams, which is constructed about 1,000 years back, 1900, 1100, that sort of temple.
What temple is this?
This is the Purnatraisha temple at the Purnatra. It's a very similar to the Chera temples in Tamil Nadu. Because Kerala was part of Chera in ancient time. Up to 11th century, it was part of the Tamil kingdom. And that influence has created this. But then again, it's totally different because the sloping roof and things like that, which is very peculiar to Kerala climate. We have a lot of, almost 6 months we have rain. So even though it is a Dravidian style, it's different from the Dravidian gobirams. Dravidian gobiram,
in fact, these roofs remind me of the temples like Hidimba temple in Himachal.
Yeah, this is the gobiram, Dravidian gobiram. This is the Dravidian gobiram. It's totally, even though it has some similarity with this gobiram, the gobiram in it's different.
Very different. In fact, these Kerala gopurams, they remind me of the temples in Himachal Pradesh, like Hidimba temple and all also.
Maybe. It's like, yes. Because all this comes under the influence of one thing, that is Vastushastra. And then depending on the climate, depending on the socio-cultural things, there are changes in the whole thing.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.